first memories I have of school were being quite good at drawing, a little bit better than the other kids. All the history books are telling you most artists have got families who say, no, you're not going to be an artist. After I graduated, I went and worked in a museum and I stopped making art completely because, in a way, the art I was making was writing. The person I chose to study often reflected in the way they were working things that unconsciously I needed answers to. And it was at that point that I quit my job in the museum and just started to make art, because I realized that the kind of questions that I was asking would be more directly addressed if I addressed them through making artwork. I mean, it was a moot point at that moment whether I was going to be a novelist or a poet or a filmmaker or a sculptor or a painter or whatever. I'd no idea exactly what form it would take. I mean, like a lot of these things that you experience consciously as, ooh, I've got a choice of a spectrum of things. So the conscious mind kind of thinks, oh, this is difficult. The unconscious mind gives you no choice. I already understood that, through the making of work anyway, that my unconscious was finely organized, non-chaotic, with a sense of some kind of purpose that we are not, as conscious people, privileged to have access to most of the time. I think that's designed into the human psyche. There's a kind of wall between those two where the kind of knowledge of deeper motives can't really pass very easily. Now, I spent all of my 20s as a kind of intellectual zealot, basically. You know, I lived the life of the intellect. So there is that aspect to me. But when I go in the studio, I found fairly quickly, and to my great regret, that none of that is useful. And this was a great shock to me. So there I had been an art historian all those years. I'd done a very good job of assuming that most artists were intellectuals. It was only when I started to make work that I realized that this artist could not be an intellectual. I cannot think in the studio. I literally cannot think. My thinking apparatus turns into a kind of soup, which in many ways is very lucky, because if I was able to think, I would certainly sit in there and think a great deal, because it's in my nature. But something happens when the studio door closes that switches it off. I literally can't think. I'm comfortably stupid when I'm in the studio. So when I say comfortable, I mean that I've learned to be comfortable with it. So I muck around. Often I do sit around doing 3FA for hours. You know, all those kind of prevarications that go on when you're supposed to be getting on with something, that still happens to me occasionally, but less and less. Often I go in the morning, shut the studio doors, and then I'm in, I don't know what I mean. I'm in my mythic zone. I'm in the realm of daydreams. I'm in this place where, particularly if I'm in the studio and there's a lot of other images that I've created around, that the more successful ones that are kind of real knots of concentrated metaphor that have come out of me and become a kind of a concentrate which settles in an image over a period of weeks when it's being made. If there are lots of those around, I feel really comfortable. I feel I'm in my library. Not only do they tell me, yes, you can do it, because when you go in the studio, I sort of assume that I can't do it every day. If there's a blank canvas there, I'm dumbfounded. How the hell am I going to do it? I'm no good. I haven't got a clue what to do with it. I am stupid. I'm in this space where I'm stupid. But the other works make me feel, yes, there's evidence that it has happened to me before, that I have made images. And they're showing this kind of mythic matrix of meanings that are somewhere out there. Well, I say out there, they're somehow in there, but they're not in the front brain space. They're in the unconscious space that, if I'm lucky, I can access. The works in Southampton cover 10 years. And before that, I was working in a way that was the result of wanting to work with the unconscious and not knowing how. I thought, oh, maybe I'll doodle it into existence. So I spent many years doodling. And I doodled some interesting things into the world. And there were moments when I thought, aha, this is the moment when this is going to lift off. This is going to start rolling. Because I could see that certain things had come into being. But they never did. And so I repeated the process ad infinitum for years, five years. There was a moment when I went in the studio, shut the door, thought, right, I'm going to get on with it again. And something snapped and I lay down on the floor and that was it. I knew it was over. I gave up utterly. I just lay there and I thought, woo, you have given this your best shot. You have given this all your energy, all your ingenuity, all your optimism that it will work if only I keep going. And it hasn't worked. I just lay there thinking, this is over. I'm done. I've failed. That's what it was. I failed. Not in a bad way. I just knew I've given this my best shot. It's failed. Whoa, what am I going to do? Giving up, you know, you can pretend to give up and you can give up truly. I was depleted. That was it. I had given up. And as I got up off the floor, something really weird happened in that I thought to myself, well, I'm just going to be as crap as I am now. I'm just going to be, I'm not going to try. I'm not going to have ambitions for my work. I'm not going to have the ambition that it should be from the unconscious. I'm not going to have the ambition that somehow it's going to have quality in the way that the people that I admire, great, you know, just interesting artists from the past. We all have these models around us that we assume that if we make an effort, we can somehow step up to the plate. All of that was gone. I just thought, as I got up off the floor, I'm going to be shit now. I am going to be shit. But ironically, it was going to be me. And believe me, it was shit. The first pictures that I made after that were done with no concern for aesthetics at all. And the other strange feeling as I rose off this floor was, not only am I going to be shit, but this is going to be the right shit. Some unbelievable trust kind of infused me from out of nowhere. I had no idea. I suddenly realized that it was going to be right, these things that I might possibly make after having given up making, that they would be right. It was a very, you can see I feel a bit kind of choked up. It's a very moving thing to remember, that trust. And so I started to make those crap paintings. So images would come to me and I would just kind of trust them. So no more doodling. I'm going to paint images that just come into the mind. If you look around at the stuff that's interested you in your life, little obsessions with different people, little obsessions with moments in history, they're telling you a hell of a lot about you. All those interests are kind of self-portraits if you gather them all in. So in a way, what the unconscious is doing is putting itself out into the world in all these various interests. And I guess my task has been to winch them all back in, to see where they came from. And so I got interested in this woman called Mandy Rice Davis, who has become one of the heroines of my little play. I mean, these things are a kind of extended drama, in a way, that's behind the paintings. When I started to make work, she appeared as a character. And how does that work? How does that work? I mean, I have said that the studio is a bit like a seance room. When I go in and shut the doors and start making a cup of coffee and mucking around, if there's a blank canvas there, I might metaphorically hear a knock on the wall as one of these spirits, as it were, wants to come in. So she was somebody who knocked and wanted to come in. And quite gradually, a whole cast of characters appeared. All of them with, I assumed, and still assume, because there are some that want to be there, I can't work out why, but I can intuit what the role psychologically, that's what it is, because what they're representing are internal forces. So they might be out in the world as real characters, but I'm not interested in them as historic figures or for what they are in their own essence. It's what my psyche made of them. Why I was interested in that one sentence she spoke, which spoke about something in me. So they are themselves, but they're not just themselves. They're also internal elements of my own psychological makeup, my character. It also links incredibly beautifully with the way that they do literally appear in dreams. So that nobody in a dream is exactly themselves. They are representations of aspects of the psyche of the dreamer, which is being embodied in some outside figure who is a symbol for that internal energy. Or entity, that's a better word, entity. So the internal entities are always looking into the outside world for things they can grab to use in the chess game of making a dream with its particular message. Often when I experience dreams, they are messages, but just representations of a psychological moment of what's actually going on inside. So that's what the stock characters are, really. They're, for me, they're my cast of characters, like dream characters, representing internal events. Well, there's a picture called My Tunguska, which was in the show. And this, it began as a single panel, central. Well, it then became a three-piece thing. But at the time, it was just a single panel. And I just felt, oh, I'll muck around and see what it's like if a figure, it becomes an aperture. So it's a sort of figure-shaped aperture that you can see through into another landscape. So it's a silhouette, as if the figure is a door or a window. And I remembered this event in Russia, in Siberia, 1908, that I'd read about, where something entered the atmosphere at high speed and never touched down. It exploded at altitude and flattened like 8 million trees. Something of that wanted to appear behind this standing figure. So, and for some reason, the comet cum meteor seemed to want to be a falling horse. I just trusted this notion that it was somehow an apt metaphor that I didn't dig around in. I was in my kind of stupid studio day kind of phase, and it just seemed a great idea. You know, that's how often these things start, their whims. So it was a whim. Oh, I'll have it as a falling horse. And there's something vaguely amusing about that. Also, the opportunity of the trailing legs, and you know, all these kind of physical pleasures in making images start to come to the fore, and then colour. Ooh, I'll have a bit of this colour, I'll have a bit of that, you know. So you're in a situation where you're just enjoying yourself, not really thinking too much about it. And I suddenly realised that it was needing another panel on the other side where there would be a dead figure. So the dead figure turned into a half-dead figure. Somebody was kneeling but clutching a wound, who was stretching an arm out to the feet of the standing figure that had this sea horizon in it. And then finally, I realized that the central figure is standing in the center of a kind of calendar that I'd already drawn 10 years earlier, which was a calendar of all the dreams that I'd ever had, and some of the works that I'd begun with, and the figure, the half-dead figure pointing at the feet of the standing figure in the center was pointing to an early work, one of the first works that I made when I started to make work. And so that somehow the arrival of the comet was as if it was that moment of my life being blasted flat, my old life, my academic life. The trees somehow symbolizing the kind of forest of ideas that I lived within. And you find your way through a forest, like a forest of ideas, by various trees that you can navigate by, ones that you use to navigate through your intellectual forest, blown flat by the moment when I stopped being an academic. You had no idea that any of that was going to emerge. All the fun of mixing the colours, all the fun of slapping it on, all the fun of then standing back and realising how it was going to grow. And that's what keeps me going into the studio, because you want that experience every time. You get addicted to that experience. During that trajectory, it seemed right to go in there and fiddle around and wait for stuff to happen. And I must say, right now, I don't feel that. I don't feel like going in there and mucking around to see what's going to come out. I think whatever's next probably needs to digest what's happened. And that's not a short process. So I might write some books, do some interviews, whatever, fill time, be a family man, you know, whilst it's processing.